It's you!
Jill?
Hi. I thought you left.
Wait, how's the fever?
The fever is down. But my head... Seneca, would you do me a favor and, take some things into my secretary? Oh, I just can't go into that office yet. And that should keep her busy through the morning. And then I'll go in later on this afternoon. I'll be okay.
This afternoon, you're going to be in bed, same as the rest of the day.
Oh, well, that sounds just lovely, but I can't. And that looks so nice.
Yeah, I thought you'd be surprised, since you can't smell anything cooking.
I can't even smell it up this close. But it looks delicious.
It is. Here, put your head back.
Oh.
Feet up.
Feet up.
There you go. Keep the tootsies warm.
Thank you.
Now eat.
Oh, well, actually, I don't have much of an appetite.
Oh. Well, try some of this. You know, if you drink lots of hot toddy and orange juice, if you eat light and you take all your medicine, you won't even have a sniffle by Christmas.
Christmas? Seneca, I am worried about getting through today. Now, my secretary is expecting
me. No. Your secretary is expecting you to stay right here. I called her. She's planning on spending the entire day typing up the strike papers.
The settlement provisions, I mean... Oh, that's right. I left them on her desk last night. You know, I'm really losing my mind.
Well, now, that's because you don't feel good, Jillian.
Mm.
Ah, good. It's down for now. Now, remember, 2 aspirins in 30 minutes. Will you remember that?
Yes, doctor, I will. You're really incredible.
Hey, now, look, I do not mean to boss you around. Seriously,
No. I know you just want to take care of me. And it feels wonderful.
Drop by around noon, all right?
You think you'll have the time?
For you? Yeah. I'll bring any messages your secretary has, but listen. Please, get right back into bed, will you?
I promise. I promise. You know, nobody has nursed me through a cold like this. Since I was a kid.
Well, it's nice for me, too, you know. Gives me a chance to show how much I love you. I like making your life pleasant. I do. Like to do it every day. Yeah. You take the medicine that Miriam is bringing over, huh? And then use these.
Yes, doctor. Thank you, doctor.
Took the words right out of my mouth. Seneca, it's good to be back.
Oh, believe me, you have been missed. It's been very rough without you. Glad you're back. Beyond that, well, the strike's over. Why don't we just zero in on the patients, huh?
Amen. Sure. Okay, let's go. Morris, what do we have here? Looks like you've got a few charts.
Yeah, I thought I was pulling just the important ones, but it turns out I was crappy the whole rack, and I think maybe I'm a little nervous. Welcome back.
Thank you, Morris.
All of you.
Thank you.
Okay. Seneca, I'll fill them in if you like. I'm on top of most of these cases.
Right. Including mine?
Of course. Look, let's start on that embolism in 604. He's stable. It was 4 days post-op, but we had some trouble with that subarachnoid hemorrhage last night.
Pat.
Yeah. Oh, sorry, I was thinking.
I just want you to know that I'm very glad that those letters of reprimand were taken out of your file. It's the best thing that could have happened.
Pat. Pat, maybe you should get in on this so I don't have to say everything twice. The surgery schedule is posted, so you better look at it. We're too tight to make any changes. In fact, take a look at it right now.
Yes, sir.
Are you all right?
Sure.
Doctor, it says here I was supposed to be at two different operations at the same time. See? Here. Yeah, and here.
Now what,
morning.
Yeah, it is.
Pat's had his future as a doctor handed back to him. Frank's getting all the credit for solving the strike, and he's got the world by the tail. Christmas is on the way, and for once, you don't know what your present is. And we got a letter from Mary.
Oh, uh-huh. John, my hands are full of this. Read it out loud.
With the greatest of pleasure. They've been to Blarney.
Oh, my.
We found the CIE tour.
You told us to take, and it was heaven. We had the world's most wonderful bus driver, whose name was Mick McGraw. Oh, he's a fierce man, Mick.
We're going on to Blarney to see this famous castle and also to kiss the stone in Blarney. And in order to kiss this stone, you have to climb up 107 steps in the interior of the castle. And when you get to the top of the parapets, you will lie down on your back to kiss the famous stone, which is said to bestow the gift of the gab or the gift of eloquence on you. Now, for those of you who do not want to venture up onto the castle to lie down in this horizontal position to kiss this stone, you can kiss it by proxy. That is, you can kiss somebody that kissed the Blarney Stone. Now, I have kissed the Blarney Stone many, many times. And this information is for the ladies only. I'm not going to kiss any gentleman, but any nice young lady who wants to kiss the Blarney Stone by proxy, I'll be available, of course, to facilitate them in this respect. There's a little jingle goes, there is a stone, whoever kisses, never misses to become eloquent. He may clamber to a lady's chamber and may become a member of Parliament. A clever spouter, he'll sure turn outer. An out and outer to be left alone. Don't try to hinder him or bewilder him, for he is a pilgrim of the Blarney Stone. So now, ladies and gentlemen, I hope you'll all be pilgrims of the Blarney Stone. And this Blarney won't work straight away when you kiss the stone. It'll take 24 hours to take an effect. And I expect to hear you all talking with great eloquence. Now, the castle was built in 1446 by Dermot McCarthy, who was the Lord of Blarney. The story of the stone goes back to many, many years ago, and it is believed that it was the Lea Fall, or the Stone of Destiny. Some people say that it was brought back from the Holy Land by pilgrims, and it was Jacob's pillow. Nevertheless, nobody knew about this Lea Fall, or the Stone of Destiny, until one day McCarthy was walking around the grounds of his castle, and he saw an old lady drowning in the moat. He jumped in and pulled her out, and for his for her gratitude, she said to McCarthy, "Any wish that you want, I will grant it to you." And McCarthy had a bit of a stammer in his speech, and he said, "If I could get rid of this stammer, I would be delighted." And she said, "There is a stone situated on the parapet of the castle, and I am the keeper of the stone. I am the castle witch. And if you get your troops to lower you out over the ankles, out over the parapet of the castle by the ankles, and kiss this stone, your impediment will leave you." Well, in the olden days, people used to be lowered out over the castle, at the parapet of the castle, to kiss this stone. But of course, nowadays, you lie down on your back, and there's a man there to hold you, and he eases you down to kiss the stone, which indeed bestows the gift of eloquence, or the gift of the gab, on you.
Jack kissed the Blarney Stone, did he? I wonder if you'll notice the difference.
Maybe so, from the sound of this.
Why, what?
You're going to like this lady. They've seen your family.
Oh, John, don't stand there, man. Now read it to me.
From Blarney, we go through Cork and on to Skibbereen.
We'd called Aunt Maura from Waterford, and she rounded up as much family as she could. Cousin Geraldine, and Joe, and Kira, and Aunt Elizabeth came over from Cork. Oh, and Uncle Tom. And Uncle Paddy.
Well, it was that.
And Paul O'Neill. And Cousin Pat O'Day. And Catherine. And the boys. David and Philip, who looked just like Frank at his age. And Brian and Catherine. And of course, little Elizabeth. Jack's head had to be reeling. I know mine was. But we both felt they'd known us and loved us forever. And they were all up to date on the news of all of us. Someone had even sent Maura a clipping from the Times about Frank's last election. I have hundreds of invitations from everyone here to everyone there. If nothing else, Mother and I have to come over next year. Maura and Elizabeth are very eager to compare grandchildren. Maura had clearly been cooking for a week, and we all sat around in the parlor eating and talking and drinking and finding out about each other. Jack fell in love several times, beginning with Joe's daughter, Kira. Uncle Patty brought a squeeze box, and that's when we missed her the most. I wanted you both there so much simply to see Jack. I don't know if it's the Irish air, the Blarney Stone, or the fact that he's at last beginning to believe we're all right. But it's not the old stand in the corner, you've got your space and I've got mine, Finelli. He was the center of everything and loving it. And they loved him.
Darling.
That kind of sharing, that belonging and give and take is what he's never had and always wanted. And it's the one thing I've always hoped I could somehow bring to him. It's happened here. And for that reason alone, I can say this trip is one of the loveliest times in my life.
I can't hear because it's not over yet.
Flying, flying. Oh,
can I get some?
Nice, isn't it? I just hope it lasts.
Oh, it'll last. I wouldn't be surprised if it lasts forever.
Huh? What the hell happened?
I don't know. I guess I fell.
Not bad.
No, no, it's just superficial.
Okay, he's all right. He's all right. He's all right.
Hey, look, hey, come on. Look, hey, look, sit down.
I'm fine.
No, sit down.
Even hurt.
Look, I'll cover for him, okay?
You want me to clean it up, Doctor?
No, I'll take care of Pat, Morris. Why don't you find somebody to sweep up this glass off
right.
The floor?
Yeah, all right. Yeah, well, right away.
Stainless, huh?
Some. I don't know how I could have done that.
You won't need stitches. You're lucky.
Yeah.
How did this happen, anyway?
I guess I tripped on the way out.
Fell against the door.
Nonsense. You didn't fall. You punched the glass out. I saw the whole thing. Claustrophobia?
Yes, I suppose so. Door stuck and I panicked.
Have you had problems with this sort of thing before?
No.
Pat, I know that I'm not your watchdog anymore, not since those letters of reprimand were taken out of your file, but nevertheless, I'm worried about you, Doctor.
You are, huh?
Seriously worried. I've seen lots of danger signals lately, and if you don't get your head together, you may not finish your residency here. And that would be a shame because you're a fine doctor.
Well, I don't know what to say to that. Thank you. I have been messed up, but it's gonna be all right.
How much sleep did you get last night?
Plenty. Hey, don't come on like a parent, all right?
I can see this hand shaking. But how come I see the other one shaking too?
I've been living on coffee. I've got to cut down, and caffeine gets me too wound up.
Just caffeine?
I don't follow.
Never mind. But you're going to start taking better care of yourself, will you? I mean it.
I guess you do. Thanks. It's good advice.
Yes, it is.